Good morning, West Baldwin United Methodist Church. Our online worship today at 10:15, just a little bit later, to allow for our 9 a.m. in-person worship at our church on 1006 Pequawket Trail in West Baldwin. I'm Pastor Bo, and my husband Tony, music director, our daughter Hope, and our cats. Franklin and Luna sometimes make an appearance, are here to worship on this wonderful Father's Day Sunday in the season after Pentecost. Just a few announcements. We will be having our Zoom fellowship right around 11 as soon as we're finished with this and can go and get set up on that. And tomorrow we will have a short meeting of the relaunch team to discuss how the in-person worship went this morning. So those are the announcements. And we do have some birthdays and anniversaries. We have Janet Lynch and Lonnie Collender, Haley Collender, and Sarah Strickland, all with birthdays this week. So please do send them some birthday greetings, or give them a call, let them know you're thinking of them, and we can sing Happy Birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Can have a moment of silence and the prelude.
The prelude this morning is in honor of Sarah Strickland's birthday. This is a song that she really enjoys. So this one is for you, Sarah. My Father is all powerful, and that you can't deny. A God of might and miracles, 'tis written in the sky. It took stars in place. It took a miracle to hang the world in space. But when he saved my soul, cleansed and made me whole. It took a miracle of love and of his mighty soul until eternity. It took a miracle to put the stars in place. It took a miracle to hang the world in space. But when he saved my soul, cleansed and made, it took a miracle and love and grace. The Bible tells us of his power and wisdom all the way through. And every little bird and flower are testimonies to. It took a miracle to put the stars in place. It took a miracle to hang the world in space. But when he saved my soul, cleansed and made me whole. It took a miracle of love and grace.
Amen. Please join me in the call to worship. The bulletin can be found on Facebook posted. And it comes from Reverend Karen Munson, who will become our district superintendent as of July 1st. Holy One in Three, you have heard and you are hearing.
You hear each of us. You see each of us.
You have loved us and you are loving us. You have loved me and you are teaching me to love all the others whom you love, all of them.
All of us.
You are complete and you are ongoing. You have done and you are doing.
I lift my arms and stretch them to you like a toddler, yearning to be picked up and held close.
I lift my arms and stretch them to you, drinking in the grace you pour.
Lift me as a vessel of your salvation.
For you have freed me to be the next in line of my ancestors, a servant of my own volition, choosing to serve love.
I lift my arms as they thrum with praise.
With the life only you can give, with the hope only you can complete. Thank you for who you have been. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for who you will be. Our first hymn this morning is in our hymnal or online, number 111, How Can We Name a Love?
Thank you.
Every family on earth receives its name. Illumine the homes of this earth with the light of your love, granting courage to those who are hurt or lonely, endurance to those who care for sick family members, and wisdom to those in fearful times of change. We thank you for gifts of love we have received from fathers and the fathering of good men. As we have been loved by you and by others, so may we love. Grant us your peace through Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is Colossians 2:11 through 15. Christ has taken away your selfish desires, just as circumcision removes flesh from the body. But when you were baptized, it was the same as being buried with Christ. Then you were raised to life because you had faith in the power of God, who raised Christ from death. You were dead because you were sinful and were not God's people. But God let Christ make you alive when he forgave all our sins. God wiped out the charges that were against us for disobeying the law of Moses. He took them away and nailed them to the cross. There Christ defeated all powers and forces. He let the whole world see them being led away as prisoners when he celebrated his victory.
The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Have you ever felt like you were trying to go up the down escalator? Or you've been pushing a wheelbarrow with square wheels? We human beings often think of following Jesus as climbing a mountain. God is up there somewhere, and we're down here, and our task is to get up there. We think of it as physical distance and geography. That's why the nations descended from Noah after the flood attempted to reach God and his heaven by building a very tall tower, the Tower of Babel. We conclude that the tools we need are stamina and climbing rigging, and that our results or our success, how good we do, is tied to our physical performance. One reason Jesus came down to us in the incarnation was to let us know that we had it wrong. We're not talking about physical locations. We're talking about spiritual maturity. God is doing for us what we cannot do for ourselves, bridging the spiritual distance between humanity and God. This happens within us, between us and others. The tools we need are more letting go, unlearning the world's ways, and getting to know and love Jesus, the Creator and the Holy Spirit. So let's explore this up and down. C.S. Lewis, 20th century English writer and theologian, says that God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks in our consciences, but shouts in our pains. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. For most of us, the spiritual journey with Jesus the Christ begins with up there thinking. But the real journey begins when we go within ourselves and expect better things from ourselves as we relate with God and others. A labyrinth is not a maze. There's only one way in, all the way to the center, and one way back out, the same way in a labyrinth. A maze has false paths that go nowhere, sometimes an unexpected shortcut directly to the exit, might have multiple entrances. Life may seem like a maze, but it is not. We aren't supposed to get out of life or find a shortcut through it. We're supposed to learn things. A labyrinth is a symbolic pilgrimage. A pilgrimage was a journey to a sacred place where people thought they could find God. So we make our journey to the center of everything, God. Then we journey back out to everything in creation, seeing everything as shining with God's fingerprints. We are transformed by going to the center, by the act of this doing, but we don't make the change happen. That's God's labor. So instead of going up that laborious mountain path, we are winding our way through the labyrinth of spiritual awareness as we cope with each step of earthly life and our own humanity. A great vacuum commercial says, "Life is messy, clean it up." And it's true, life is messy. We want to rise above it, to get out of it, to escape it. Those lovely upward winding mountain roads attract us again and again, take us away from here. But Jesus came down here among us as one of us, born into a messy and mostly unremarkable life for 30 years or so. Over and over, our scripture writers tell us that Jesus emptied himself, was tempted as we are, lived with weakness, brokenness, and every human emotion. Jesus walked and enjoyed and suffered the entire human journey. His life is the prototype, the exemplary example of human living, a hidden divine conception, a regular adult life with people to love and many problems, brief moments of transfiguration, a deep and compelling seeing of God's presence in everything and everyone around him, terrible suffering, death, resurrection, and a glorious ascension. Do you think we do not experience all of these things? God, the source of life, was hidden but present in our own miracle of conception. We have brief moments of being our better selves. We catch more and more glimpses of that brightness until we are perfected by God. We too are headed for death and resurrection, and will be with Christ, Creator and Comforter, in the kingdom of heaven forever. We will, at least in that sense, ascend. Jesus offers us a living example of fully embodied love that emerged out of ordinary, even economically and socially disadvantaged or poor circumstances. He suffered pains and joys throughout his life, just as we do. He was wounded and also resurrected. Remember, he carried his wounds after he was risen. He told Thomas to put his fingers to his wounds. Great love and great suffering bring us to God moments, deep and profound experiences of God's presence. We too carry our wounds with us. We can use those wounds to build walls between us and pain, between us and other people, between us and God, between us and living real lives. But if we move towards spiritual maturity, we grow in love, gratitude, faith, and trust precisely because of those moments that wound. We can't skip over the messiness of earthly life. Jesus didn't. We must experience both our own wounds and the woundedness of all around us in order to love God. And only if we love God can we find the means to love ourselves and one another and all of creation. We must love God through, in, with, and even because of the world. This is what Jesus showed us. My favorite American artist, Georgia O'Keeffe, a 20th century artist, said this. She's known for painting flowers particularly that were
as large as this wall.
As large as this wall. A flower is relatively small. Everyone has many associations with a flower, the idea of flowers. Still, in a way, nobody sees a flower, really. It's so small, we haven't time. And to see takes time, like to have a friend takes time. So I said to myself, I'll paint what I see, what the flower is to me, but I'll paint it big, and they will be surprised into taking time to look at it. We're coming to the idea of respect and reverence. Respect, literally, is to re-spect, re-inspect, to see again, to take another look, to take a deeper look, to look and contemplate what you see. It is to look at the wounds of others and creation and see beauty, resilience, dignity. Reverence is to respect, to be in awe of, to worship. It's the result of the more and more deeply seeing of what you respect. We know we are growing in spiritual maturity when we have more reverence and respect for creation than we have contempt or criticism. Another way to understand what Jesus reveals to us about God. Jesus gives us a tangible, physical faith. It's what we've all been missing in quarantine and what we wanted with our in-person worship. Touching and being touched by one another is safety, community, love, and brings forth justice. Now we cannot touch one another yet, but touching one another's pain and suffering is a way into compassion and understanding. It's the only thing that can stir us to actions of mercy, kindness, and transformation in ourselves or in society. Our Christian way is based on a deep relationship with the triune God. We do not say we had to have lived when Jesus was active in ministry on earth in order to really know Jesus. Rather, Paul said his experience with Jesus on the Damascus Road, well after Jesus' ascension, was just as real as Peter and the other apostles' experience of living with Jesus. And it's just as real as our own experience of Jesus the Creator, Jesus the Christ, God the Creator, and the comforting Holy Spirit. Getting to the depth of things, the fullness of things, the soul of things, is to search within the common and ordinary of everyday life for the sacred presence of God, to respect, and reverence. That's the spiritual journey. Have you had a profound experience of God? We shared a few this morning at our in-person worship. Tell someone about yours today, and tell me, because I would like to hear it. If you have not had a profound experience of God, begin a journey with me. Begin with 30 minutes of quiet prayer. Starting next week, I will post online some videos on quiet meditative prayer with the Psalms and other short scripture passages, and offer simple questions to guide you on your way. Amen. So we continue with lifting up our joys and concerns. And we did have an update at the in-person worship of Pat's sister, Annette. A joyous news that the CAT scan results came in and the cancerous lymph nodes were clear, and the areas of cancer in the lungs were shrunk. So the treatment has worked and has remained stable while she's been without treatment during this time to feel better and not have some of the side effects that the medications were giving her. So God's answered our prayers as we would have wished, and we continue to lift her up in prayer. Are there others from online? No. Okay. I would like to offer a praise of our few days away together. We didn't take a whole week off, but for our anniversary, we took a few days down at the beach, trying to practice social distancing, and that was its own complication. Got a little too much sun in spots, but it was beautiful. It was wonderful. And it is a celebration of God's creation and of 30 years of marriage. Thank you so much, honey.
And a quick shout out to my niece, Emmy. Her graduation is tonight.
Yes.
So they'll be adhering to the social distancing, but wishing you the best, Emmy. Congratulations.
Yes, congratulations. And for all those who know graduates and that are going through these ceremonies without the routines we've become familiar with, we can celebrate with you all and lift you up for comfort for any feelings of loss. Let us pray. Oh God, you hold us in the palm of our hands. Help us to choose to re-inspect you and revere you. Help us to see and to find you, and to grow in our spiritual maturity. We have before you many joys, graduations and clear medical results and beauty of nature, opportunities to celebrate. We have joys on our hearts we have not raised, and we lift them up to you now. And we say together, Lord, hear our praise. And we remember that hand in hand in life's journey, there are difficulties, challenges, concerns. We have before us requests for healing, for guidance, for comfort, for strength. And we remember your presence is with us throughout it all. At this time, you can lift up the concerns on your heart that you did not raise. Lift them up to God. And we say together, Lord, hear our prayers. And we continue with the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And we now move into a time of remembering our presentation of tithes and offerings. Those in in-person worship this morning offered their physical tithes and offerings to the offering plate, but we can also remember what we give to one another, the way that we look out for one another during these times, the way others have cared for us and looked out for us, the connections between us, and also what we may have sent to the church at the church's mailing address. So we lift up all these things as we hear our offertory and offer the sung doxology and prayer of dedication. Take away what you have given in your Son, Jesus Christ. You have given all that I could desire. What joy! I love you, Lord. Mine are the heavens, the earth, the peoples. Mine are the just, the sinners, and the angels. God, you yourself are mine, for mine is Christ. And everything is for me. I hide myself in you. Let me be as generous with all creation as you. Amen. Our last hymn, as I said last week, we're going to be learning the Together We Serve, so we will sing that again.
Sorrow and joy.
benediction is from Teresa of Avila, a 16th century contemplative nun from Spain. Let nothing disturb you. Let nothing frighten you. All things will pass away. God never changes. Patience obtains all things. Whoever has God lacks nothing. God alone suffices. Amen.
For the postlude today, in recognition and in honor of Father's Day, I picked a song that came out in 1981. Dan Fogelberg had written this to really honor and recognize his father, Lawrence, who was a musician and at the time a leader of the band. The song did very well. It charted. I don't remember how high it got on the charts. And the funny story is that Lawrence got a lot of recognition and a lot of media attention about the song and people wanting to know, you know, who was this inspiration for Dan, who, you know, wrote and performed the song. And he did a lot of interviews, and unfortunately, it was in 1982, a year after it was released, that Lawrence passed away. But, you know, this song has always been special to me, and, you know, I can struggle at times to get through the end of the third verse, but I hope that you all enjoy this. And for all the fathers, biological fathers, father figures, the fathers in our lives, we all appreciate what you've done for us, what you stand for. I dedicate this to all the fathers. A son. His hands were made for different work, and his heart was known to none. He left his home and went his lone and solitary way, and gave to me a gift I know I never can repay. A quiet man, the music denied a simpler fate. He tried to be a soldier once, but his music wouldn't wait. He earned his love through discipline, a thin, grim velvet hand. His gentle means of sculpting souls took me years to understand. The leader of the band is tired and his eyes are growing old. His blood runs through my instrument, and a song is in my soul. My life has been a poor attempt to imitate the man. I'm just a living legacy to the leader of the band. My brothers' lives were different, for they heard another call. One went to Chicago the other to St. Paul. And I'm in Colorado when I'm not in some hotel, living out this life I chose and have come to know so well. The leader of the band is tired and his eyes are growing old, but his blood runs through my instrument and his song is in my soul. My life has been a poor attempt to imitate the man. I'm just a living legacy to the leader of the band. I thank you for the music and your stories of the road. I thank you for the freedom when it came my time to go. I thank you for the kindness and the times when you got tough. And Papa, I don't think I said I love you near enough. The leader of the band is tired and I'm growing old, but his blood runs through my instrument and his song is in my soul. My life has been a poor attempt to imitate the man. I'm just a living legacy to the leader of the band. I'm just a living legacy to the leader of the band.
Happy Father's Day. Please join us for fellowship at 11. Have a good day.